Hi everyone, welcome to the online worship service of Epworth United Methodist Church and Crosswood United Methodist Church here in Marion, Ohio. I'm Reverend Jennifer Bass and it is wonderful to be in worship with you all today. Today is Holy Communion Sunday, it's World Communion Sunday. And so I invite you to take a moment and maybe pause the video and go and get communion elements, something that will make do for bread today for the body of Christ, something that will make do for juice. If you have grape juice, that would be wonderful. If not, coffee or tea, something that will that we can use later on in our worship service today so that we can have Holy Communion together as Christian believers are doing all across the world today in the name of Jesus Christ. So, and also, if you have a moment, light a candle as a symbol that God is with us as we worship together. And I invite us to join together in our opening hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Let's sing.
Would you please join with me in our responsive reading? You have called us to this place, O Lord. Each one of us is blessed by God with unique and differing gifts and talents, and with God-given means and resources. Each talent represented here is valuable in God's realm, and God instructs us to entrust a portion of our resources, all of which are gifts from God's hand, back to God for the building of God's kingdom. Lord, show us the ways in which we are to use our gifts for healing and hope and for your kingdom-building purposes. Each talent, each skill, each resource, each gift that we bring can be used by God for peace and justice in Jesus' name to change people's lives in our community and around the world. Enable us, O God, as individuals and as a church, to discern what you would have us do. Amen. Our New Testament lesson today is taken from Matthew 6, verses 1 through 4, 19 through 21, and 24 through 33. Hear these words. Jesus said, "Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets to be honored by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and vermin destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and vermin do not destroy, where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all of his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, 'What shall we eat?' or 'What shall we drink?' or 'What shall we wear?' For the pagans run after all of these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all of these things will be given to you as well." This is the word of God for all of God's children. Thanks be to God. Please join with me in a moment of prayer. Jesus, on this World Communion Sunday, we ask that you would give us eyes to recognize your reflection in the eyes of Christians everywhere. As we come before you this day, so very aware that we are all part of your global family of faith, we remember those who feel far from us. We ask that you would be with all of our siblings in the faith, most particularly with those we find it hard to understand or hard to love. We ask that you would bless them. We ask that you would move in wondrous ways in their lives, and that you would help us to see and love them as you do. We ask that you would be with all of those who feel forgotten. Be with the homebound, be with the imprisoned, be with the persecuted. Comfort the grieving and the lonely and the lost. Be with those who suffer and those who sorrow. Be with those who stand alone. We ask that they would know your great love for them, and that you would help us to love them as you do. For in you, we are all one body, as we're celebrating here together on this World Communion Sunday. God, we ask that Christians all around the world would find their hearts moved with love for one another as an act of love for you. Pour out your blessings on each and every church, on every pastor, every leader, every Christian nonprofit and ministry, everyone who bears the banner of Christ, we ask you would bless them. Cause them to prosper and to shine the light of your love to the farthest ends of the earth. God, we ask that you would be with all of your children, that you would bless each and every one. Let them know how deeply beloved and cherished they are by you, and help us to love and honor each other as you've called us to do. Jesus, we ask for the grace to love each other well, to love as you love, to look to that which unifies us and not that which divides us, for the glory of your name, that we might love you well. We pray in your name, Jesus. Amen.
In the late 1600s, a German preacher named August Frank founded an orphanage to care for the homeless children in his town. One day, when Frank desperately needed financial support to carry on his good work, a needy widow came to his door begging for just one gold coin to help make ends meet. Because of his personal financial situation, the preacher politely but regretfully told her that he just could not help her. Totally discouraged, tears began streaming down the widow's face. Frank was heartbroken. He asked the widow to wait a moment, and he went inside his house to pray. After he prayed about it for a few minutes, he sincerely felt that God wanted him to change his mind. He felt God saying to him, "Trust me to meet your needs." So Frank went back to the door and he gave the widow his very last gold coin. 2 days later, Frank received a note of thanks from the widow. She said that because of his generosity, she was praying and asking God to just shower both him and the orphanage with financial resources. Frank thought to himself, well, from her lips to God's ears. Later that day, though, out of the blue, a wealthy lady stopped at Frank's home and she gave him 12 gold coins to support his work at the orphanage. And then he received 2 more gold coins from a friend. The preacher was stunned. 14 gold coins. He thought God had amply repaid him for helping the widow by giving her his last gold coin. But then a few days later, he was informed that the orphanage would receive 500 gold pieces from the estate of the Prince of Germany himself. When he heard this news, Frank wept with gratitude. He had followed God's prompting to give one coin, his own last coin, to the widow in need, afraid that he would be impoverished himself. But he had not been impoverished at all, as he had worried he would be. No, he and his good work had somehow been, by the grace of God, miraculously enriched instead. In the Gospel of Matthew chapter 6, Jesus said, "So do not worry, saying, 'What shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear?'" Maybe in modern times, you and I would say, "Where will the money come from?" For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. My dear friends, a review of the teachings of Jesus could almost be summarized in one word: give. And as we continue with our sermon series through the month of September and October, as we engage in our annual stewardship campaign to support God's ministry through the church by our prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness, a discipleship sermon series to join God in God's work in our community, in our state, in our nation, in our world, by our prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. Well, today's theme is that there is a blessing in giving generously. There's a blessing in joining God's work by giving to God our gifts. Now listen, when you go to a doctor for your annual checkup, he or she will often begin to poke and prod and press on various places, and they'll ask you, "Does this hurt? How about this? How about that? If you cry out in pain, one of two things has happened. Either the doctor has pushed way, way too hard without any sensitivity and they have actually harmed you, or there might actually be something wrong. And the doctor will say, well, we'd better do some more tests. It's not supposed to hurt right there. That's kind of how it is when pastors preach about giving, about generosity, giving of ourselves and our resources and our gifts. Some folks might cry out in discomfort, criticizing the message or the messenger. And either the pastor has pushed way, way too hard with no sensitivity and has actually done harm, or perhaps there might actually be something going on under there. And in that case, I say, my friends, we are all in need of the great physician, because it's not supposed to hurt when pastors gently but honestly push on the area of giving generously from our gifts. My job as your pastor is to remind you that everything we have comes from God's hand. And God instructs us to give back to God with faith and trust. My job is to remind you that we can never outgive God. Money, talent, creativity, aptitude, ability, material, resources, those things are renewable resources that come from God's hand into our lives and into our church. And God asks us to trust God and to give generously, to be conduits of God's blessings to others. So Pastor Kristen and I are taking this opportunity, especially as the church prays and plans and prepares for next year's powerful and effective ministry in Jesus' name, to explore the theme of generous living that we find in the scriptures. Giving generously from our gifts. Christians of all people should be generous with the resources God has given to us. So today, the truth of Scripture is that there is a blessing in giving from the gifts God has given to us. Now, can you testify that that has been true in your life, that there's a real blessing in giving? The first Christmas that Jared and I were dating, we were dating long distance. He lived in Houston, Texas, and I lived in Central Ohio. When he visited Columbus for Christmas that year, we were extremely anxious to give each other the Christmas presents we had specially chosen for one another. I gave him a book of Pablo Neruda's poetry that Neruda wrote at the very end of his life, complete with beautiful black and white photographs of Neruda's seaside cottage in Cuba. And I was an English major, so I marked the heck out of those poems. I jotted all my thoughts and other connections in the margins. I pasted in our ticket stubs to the Nutcracker Ballet, which was our very first official date, and to Star Wars The Force Awakens, which was our second date. I wrote notes to him throughout that entire book. And so he opened the present, and at first he was like, oh, what a lovely book. And then he started turning the pages. And I could see on his face that he realized it was so much more than just a book. And he got emotional about it with tears in his eyes. And I had put together a memento box for him to take back to Houston. He and I had been friends for years, and I had come across some family treasures of his. So I had in that memento box a quilting square that his grandmother had made and a handwritten note I had found from his mom, and one of her teacups and saucers. And I tucked in there a handmade zebra Christmas ornament from Kenya, where I had experienced my call to ministry, and a hand-carved bear made out of marble stone, because Jared's nickname has always been Bear. And anyway, the tears just spilled out. He grabbed me and he hugged me, and I was over the moon because I had given him such a special present. And then I opened my present from him, and it was a brand new laptop computer. And I'll tell you, I bawled like a baby, because mine had been on its very last leg and was about to permanently crash. And Jared had saved the day. I was a seminary student at the time, paying my own way through school, and I couldn't afford a new computer, and he had taken care of it for me. And in that moment, I'll tell you, we were both blessed by receiving good gifts, certainly. But more than that, we were blessed by how we had chosen to give good gifts. I'll bet, and I hope, that you have stories like that in your life too. A time when you were absolutely blessed to give. There is a real blessing in giving. I want you to consider the evidence in Scripture. In Luke 6:38, Jesus said these words, "Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put into your lap. For the measure you give will be the measure you get back." Or take Jesus' statement in Luke 14:13. "When you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed from heaven." In Acts 20:35, the Apostle Paul says that Jesus said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." The Message version puts it like this: "You're far happier giving than getting." Now, the problem with a teaching like that, maybe especially in our day and age, I think, is that we simultaneously believe it and we doubt it. I mean, we think it must be true, but then again, it doesn't sound true at all. Nowadays, we are all tempted to get captured by getting. We are all tempted by acquiring, by the call of the mall, by the call of Amazon.com, by QVC Shopping Network on the TV, by Target and all the things we don't need there, by Home Depot and Menards, etc., etc. Am I right? It is so easy to buy into, pun intended, the illusion that spending our resources to get more and more stuff for ourselves will somehow make our lives complete. So we shop and shop and shop. We fuss and fuss and fuss. We acquire more and more and more. But our lives are not any more complete. Our problems are not fixed. We don't look like the airbrushed people in the magazines, and our homes do not look like the ones in Good Housekeeping magazine. Getting does not solve our issues. Or we hoard all our resources to ourselves. We focus on keeping instead of giving. We compile. We hang on to and protect our stuff like a dragon hoards a little pile of gold. We hear Jesus say to us, "You're far happier giving than getting," but we don't want to relax our grip on our stuff because we conflate stuff with security. We think our stuff keeps us safe. And yet Jesus tells us to give. Jesus tells us we'll be happier and blessed if we give. And we actually need it to be true. Because as we live, we realize that no matter how much we get, it doesn't succeed in making us perfectly happy and contented. It doesn't succeed in protecting us. We discover that if we want our lives to mean something, if we want our lives to mean more, then we need to be able to live open-handedly and generously toward each other. We need to give from our gifts, just as God has designed and instructed us to. Instinctively, we know that greater living, the higher form of living that demonstrates the happiness and the contentment and the deep meaning we each want from this life, comes from giving. Giving of our time and our energy, giving of our possessions and our money, giving from our gifts. Contemporary research reveals what Jesus knew here through spiritual instinct. The six greatest needs of every human being are meaning, or purpose, self-esteem, loving relationships, spiritual connection, security, and a sense of legacy, a sense that the meaning of our lives will last after we're gone. Why did Jesus talk so much about money and about giving from our gifts and talents? Why do so many of Jesus' parables discuss the appropriate and inappropriate use of money and our material resources in this life? Friends, it is because money and stuff has the power to help or hinder people from meeting these six basic human needs that determine the quality of our daily living and the quality of the meaning we make of our lives right here and right now and long after we are gone. Money and stuff have the power to derail God's purpose for our lives if we let that money and stuff take priority and first place in our lives instead of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why over and over God instructs us to give. To give. To trust that God will continue to supply all of our needs. And to give. We are not here just to get. We are not here just to keep. We are here to give. Giving, supporting God's work in the world by our gifts is one crucial step in living the God-honoring life that we all really want for ourselves. Captain Henry Levi, a Christian believer from Philadelphia in the 1910s, was once asked how he could give so much to the Lord's work and still possess such great wealth. The captain shrugged, and he replied with a smile, "Well, as I shovel it out, God shovels it in. And what I have found is that the Lord has a much bigger shovel than I do." And you and I know that this sermon is about way more than just tithing, way more than just the financial resources God has given to us. You and I know that we give to God and to the church in terms of our time, our talent, our energy. Regularly, week by week, you and I have the opportunity to sow good seeds into our neighborhoods, into our families' lives, into our friends' lives, into our communities, and into the world, and into the life we have always wanted. A blessed life, a life of generosity, a life of trusting God to work through us, a life of showing God that we can be trusted to be good stewards of all of the gifts we have received from God, and a life of believing in God's faithfulness to renew all of God's resources for God's ongoing work. Amen. Let's go to a time of Holy Communion together. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You have blessed us with bountiful gifts, talents and capacities, abilities and strengths, aptitudes and hard wirings, means and resources. You have created us wonderfully diverse with so much to give, and you have shown your people that it is good and right to express gratitude for the many blessings you have bestowed upon us, to give our gifts back to you in praise and thanksgiving, using our giftings and our resources generously in the building of your kingdom. So, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit gifted him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. Jesus healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When Jesus ascended to heaven, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and by the presence of the Holy Spirit that endows us now with spiritual gifts and anoints us now to take up Christ's work for the ongoing building of your kingdom. On the night in which Christ gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. As often as you eat of this, do it in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this as often as you do in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, the best gift we will ever receive, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, a gift of ourselves back to you, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us pray the prayer Jesus taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Friends, this is the body of Christ, broken for you, the blood of Christ, shed for you. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Amen. We conclude our worship service today with the beautiful and fitting hymn, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross." Let's worship together. Thank you.
Receive this benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.